Okay, I'm going to go ahead and kick us off. Welcome to the first webinar in our series, CS Plus. Today we are going to be hearing from three amazing technologists working in the medical device industry, working and studying, I should say, in the medical device industry, and learning a little bit more about what they do and how they use computing and technology within their roles. So first, if you did not know, welcome. This is the National Center for Women and Information Technology, otherwise known as NCWIT. NCWIT is a nonprofit community that was founded in 2004 to convene, equip, and unite more than 1,500 change leader organizations across the country and in actually US territories and like overseas now. We're international, but all with the explicit purpose to increase the meaningful and influential participation of all women at every intersection, and gender non-binary individuals in computing and technology. We are particularly focused on the field of innovation and development, but also all intersections of technology and computing within any industry. This series is being funded by the DoD STEM Project, and we're very appreciative of them. We're going into our third or fourth year of partnership with the DoD STEM. DoD STEM provides learning opportunities from elementary school to graduate school to inspire and cultivate a diverse pool of exceptional STEM talent. After this webinar, I'm definitely going to share some resources and information that can be used to learn more about careers and opportunities with the DoD STEM program and the Department of Defense. And now I am going to invite my fellow panelists to come on camera, and we're going to start with some introductions. Today's webinar is going to be a little bit different in that I don't necessarily have a lot of questions ready. I want this to be a conversation between our panelists and you all. So please start. I haven't seen any pop in yet, but start populating us with some questions. Oh, I do see a question. Someone said that the chat is disabled, so I should fix that first. So I'll work on that. But try to, start populating some questions in the webinar chat, not necessarily the Q&A, while I try to figure out what that is. Oh, okay, never mind. Someone on the back end let me know that it's been fixed. Okay. So we'll continue. So this conversation is really an example or an opportunity for you to speak to people who are currently in the medical device field. So we really want to be led by your questions, your interests. I'm going to turn it over now and stop talking to Adonna to lead us, kick us off with introductions.
Hi everyone. I am excited to be here and to talk to all of you. So my name is Adonna Anderson, and I am currently an electrical engineering manager at Medtronic. So I know that for introductions, it's kind of a little bit about my journey and kind of how I got here, and I'll tie in some computer science. So just to start off, I was in high school when I decided that I would be an engineer. Middle school, really, it was really more my mom. She said, "Hey, you like math, you like science." I looked up on the internet that there's this thing called an engineer. We did not know anything about engineering. Go on this website that talks about women in engineering and figure out what you want to do when you get older. And so I went on that website and I was like, "Oh, computer engineering, that looks awesome." And so from middle school until I went into college, I was like, "I'm going to be a computer engineer." I got into college, and actually I decided I didn't want to be a computer engineer, and I switched to electrical engineering, which is kind of funny because, one of the reasons was around coding, right? And it was really difficult for me, when I joined school and I went to my first programming class. And since then, my previous college, Cal Poly, which I'm an alumni of now, they started you in C programming. And so that was really difficult for me coming in, never having coded. I know I said I was interested in computer engineering, but I never coded anything. Like, I made a website, like, and I thought that was, what it was, to be honest. And I went into this class with all of these people who had honestly seemed like they had coded so many things. And I felt so behind. And then I also realized that I felt like I didn't like coding. And so then I went into electrical engineering, which in my electrical engineering role, I've actually done a lot of coding. So as a direct electrical engineer, I've actually used C, I've used Python, I've used other programming languages to kind of, you know, move along in my career. So currently, like I said, I work at Medtronic. I kind of got into biomedical devices just kind of by chance. And honestly, I absolutely love it. So I wasn't one of the people that went and majored in biomedical, but I got into medical devices as an electrical engineer. And I just really enjoy the impact to the patient. So I specifically work on diabetes products. So that's the pumps and the continuous glucose monitors. And it's just something about, you know, knowing that every day I'm impacting a patient. I work in the sustaining group, which is basically released products. And so if I don't, you know, fix an issue, then there may be a patient that doesn't have my product. And it's just super impactful, a lot of fun, and I just love it. So that's kind of my introduction. I don't know if there should be more, but...
No, I'm sure we'll dive into a whole bunch after we start with questions. Okay, so now we are going to move on to Christi and give Christi the opportunity to introduce herself. Go ahead, Christi.
Hi, guys. So this is Christi Fernandes. I'm a first-year grad student at CU Boulder. I'm for biomedical engineering as well. So giving a bit of background, I did my bachelor's in biomedical engineering as well from MSAP, and how this path came out for biomedical engineering is a super fun one. Let me just give you a gist of it. We will dive back into deep. Let's other questions in the come up. So I started with an inclination towards medical engineering, and I hope I'm audible, right?
What'd you say?
I hope I'm audible, right?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. So, we started with information towards medical field, that is being a doctor, but then somewhere it's like, this is something not that I like, but then engineering is something I like, and let's go into a fusion of medical ops engineering, and that's where I came in with the time for biomedical engineering. That's how I went through it, and there's a never turning back moment for me in my life. And then I did my undergrad, and now I'm in my first year grad student studies, and I'm more inclined towards ultrasound imaging and medical imaging. I'm also part of the engineering lab here at CU Boulder, and we're discovering more ways of reducing the redundancy with images. That's pretty much about me.
Thanks, Christi. And I think you're right. Someone did say that they're not able to hear you completely. So we can test that in the next segment. But for now, let's turn it over to Anna to introduce herself.
All right, perfect. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Hi, everyone. My name's Anna Urias, and I am a senior undergraduate student at the University of Nevada, Reno, and I'm double majoring in biomedical and electrical engineering with a minor in mathematics. And I guess for my story, it's a little bit of a complicated one, but I'm going to try to keep it concise. So when I was in high school, I thought that I would be doing something more in the medical field. So I applied to most schools as a biology major, chemistry, things like that. And then when I was, you know, right before I ended up going, you know, to university, I had watched my dad for a few years have multiple surgeries on his spine due to a degenerative condition. And then right before I started my freshman year in college, he got a spinal cord stimulator for chronic pain. And seeing the impact that a medical device had on his life and his pain was really impactful to me. So I was flipping through my course catalog and I saw a bunch of classes under biomedical engineering, which I had never heard of. And so I changed my major to engineering a week before I started college with absolutely no technical background. So I had never worked with circuits. I had never worked with code. And then when I entered school, I was exposed to a lot of new things that I had never touched before in my life. Like Adonna said, my first experience with code was in C. So maybe that's usually what they do in the introductory to computer science classes. And it was very difficult for me in the beginning, but after working on it and getting exposure to it throughout my classes, I've been able to do things like study biomechanics, so human gait analysis or analyzing bending of like human finger and the joint angle. I've been able to work on cell segmentation and image analysis. And actually, I this past summer got to work on Adonna's team at Medtronic, where I worked on a program for failure analysis for a continuous glucose monitor, where I would take in data from the glucose monitor and then analyze, did the voltage fall too low below the minimum threshold? Did the device disconnect from its corresponding smartphone or insulin pump? How long did it disconnect? And analyzing data like that. So I'm happy to answer any questions on, you know, my personal experience or my academic or industry journey as well.
Thank you, Anna. And also thank you for the invitation to probe into your personal experiences, because that's where we're going to start. So you definitely touched on where your interest, how you realized your interest in like the medical devices industry. I'm interested in hearing a little bit more about any obstacles or barriers that you faced when, as you started pursuing this degree. You mentioned a couple, but how you overcame them and what some strategies were that you implemented.
Yeah, sure thing. I would say that some of the obstacles, obviously I had never worked with any of this before, so it was all very new. And I think the thing that had a big impact on me was probably looking around and seeing, wow, you know, some of my friends have been working on robotics since they were in middle school, and they are very familiar with all of the introductory knowledge and courses. So that was a bit scary or nerve-wracking to see that, you know, I just felt really behind and like there was no way I could catch up. But I think that what I used to sort of help that feeling, number one, I go to office hours a lot still to this day. Working with professors has always been something that I found to be extremely useful. Number one, you get a good relationship with them, so it becomes easier to ask them questions over time. And they're usually really receptive to helping you with anything you might be stuck on. Two, I recommend forming study groups. That's another thing that's helped me a lot, because there might be something that I understand that my friends don't, or maybe my friends understand a concept that I don't get. And collaboration has always been something that works really well for me instead of just reading a textbook. So I think those are some of the tools that I've used to try to expand like my technical knowledge.
Thank you. And then we will bump to Christi. Do you want to talk a little bit about some of your challenges and barriers that you experienced so far as you've been pursuing your education?
Sure enough, to go through the challenges that I faced. So giving a brief idea, I'm also an international student. So I've just started with my grad studies in States. And it has been a major step, I would say. Like, this was something that I ever seen when I was back in my home country. So the thing, I felt many cultural shocks with the education system or with the college system going around. But the thing I would suggest is go to numerous websites. Reach out to your professor. That's the most helpful thing that I have ever experienced. So before I came to States, I started communicating with my lab professors, talking to them, and comparing what I should be doing before I came, so that I was mentally prepared for what I'm going to expect from you. So, I am a part of the medicine imaging laboratory. So before I came here, I started knowing what I was to be majoring, how various modalities present in the imaging. Though I've had some experience with it, but there are many differences that you never know. The professor expects something else from it. So better than you communicate, and that's the best way you can work. you know, there's no point attacking. Personally, there's no point in hesitating. You know, just getting your chances lower by just getting in there, by thinking, oh my God, what the professor will think of me. Don't think about you will laugh at me. Just speak out of that. And that's what I did. And that's how I approach you right now. I'm still in my own space, I would say. I'm still sitting around, getting around things. But that's how things learn. You better know. So just that, when, as Anna Rising said, you study more. This is the best way you can learn. I'm tired of studying more. And oh my God, this is explained some of the things that are not known to me. And it's like, naive in it. Yep.
Sorry, I hate to interrupt you. Can you try remove your earphones?
Okay.
I don't know. Yeah, I think that the microphone is not picking you up.
Okay, fine. Shut up.
And then Christi, we'll come back. Oh no, are you ready?
Am I audible now?
Yes, much better.
Go ahead. Oh my God, I'm so sorry. So yeah. So shall I start from the beginning, or did you all hear something out, or
I would say start from the beginning.
Okay, great.
Full beginning, but just so you know. Yeah.
All right. So I'm an international student. So coming from an international background and coming to States. So I've just been in States for 2 months now, but it has been a bumpy ride, I would say. So there are many different things that I see and, you know, experience. And as Anna rightly said, that making a study group is a very helpful thing. So when I came here, before I came to the States, I started communicating with my lab professors. So I'm a part of an ultrasound imaging laboratory. So I used to communicate with the professor, ask him what he expects from me or what learnings I should have before I came. So it makes me mentally prepared for it. So there's, you know, I won't say that you're not known with anything, or I was not known with this concept, but still, you know, when you communicate with the professor feels that you are getting interested in that. I will suggest that talk with your professors, know how things work, explore yourself. There's no point in hesitating, is what I feel. Like, you, by hesitating, you're just making your chances a little bit less. So try to talk with your partners, try to talk with your friends, attend office hours, they are the best, I would say. You just get out more knowledge from it and you're just good to go. So yeah, that's how my journey has been. And there's many more things happening. I would say I'm still naive in that. I'm still learning, exploring, making mistakes, multiple mistakes, but that's how life works. So that's how I would say there were the challenges and that's how I'm tackling right now. I'm still going through it.
Thank you so much, Christi. Okay, and Adonna, I'm going to give you the opportunity to just talk about the experiences you've had, because you are actually in the workforce, and kind of some of the challenges and barriers that you faced there.
Yeah, definitely. So first I'll say, you know, there obviously, even NCWIT exists for a reason. There's not a lot of women in the field. And so typically I am one of the only women on my team. I was one of the only electrical engineer women in a lot of my labs and things like that. So I think that one of the big challenges is kind of navigating that and navigating kind of some of the things that makes me feel, in a sense, in the workplace, right? So it can be difficult and it can feel like you have to prove yourself more. And so kind of how I face that, to not discourage everybody, but, you know, for me, it's really about continuing to push forward and work hard and then find those people that do support you and find those other people that do look like you, so that you can, you know, have those conversations and kind of do that. And then also as a manager, honestly, hiring those people, right? So I am a big advocate of hiring women and people of color. And I think that it's important to have a diverse workforce. And I think that there's great talent like Anna, who was on my team, and I wish I could hire her full time, but she's going to grad school, but that's her own story. And so there's amazing women engineers out there who are very smart, who can do all of these jobs. And it's just taking the time to find those. So I would say, so that's definitely one of my biggest obstacles, I would say. And then the other is just kind of learning the corporate environment. So I come from a family that wasn't necessarily in a corporate environment. So kind of learning things around that, such as always negotiate pay and, like, you know, things like that, of like how to navigate in corporate America and to be successful. Because yes, you're doing CS in medical devices, but you're working in corporate America, and part of that is part of it, right? And so that's a big one. And then I think the things that are fun that are no longer obstacles for work is that learning side, right? So I think that that is the best part of it, is learning new technology, making an impact on that technology, and things like that. So
thank you. And you kind of queued up our next question. Would you recommend going to grad school if you were interested in working with CS in the medical device field? And let's start with our current graduate student, which is Christi.
Yeah, I would suggest that you can explore yourself. You can know more about it. So personally, I come from biomedical engineering background as itself. And I came from where the thing is like, I'm an international student, so I don't have much idea about how things work in States. But usually it is, we carry a degree from the bachelor's, whatever I did, I carried forward it. So I did my bachelor's in biomedical engineering, and I did carry forward it towards my grad studies as well. In States, it might be thing that you can do a CS and then navigate to medical devices field. The medical device field is vast. I won't say it's restricted to something else. So there's computer engineering, electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, everything going on simultaneously. Personally, in my grad school as well, there's nothing called as a biomedical engineering program. It is an amalgamation of every field. So you get courses from computer science, electrical engineering. If you're doing your course in CS, and then want to apply those knowledge in medical devices, that's a great way. I will say you know much more than any other biomedical engineering student, because you have done your expertise in there and you're applying it to there. So I will say there's no harm if you have a pure interest in developing your technical knowledge there and then applying that in the medical device field.
Adonna? And I mean, you all can just jump in, actually. I don't have to prompt you. Who's next? Adonna, Anna?
Yeah, I can go. So I think it is definitely something that is a personal decision and depends on what you want to do with your career. So I think that there's a lot of opportunities for undergrad students to come into a medical tech company and start working on med devices and start coding. But if you want to do something very specific, sometimes it makes more sense to go get a graduate degree in that, right? So it really kind of depends on your situation and kind of what level you want to do that. So typically a master's degree may give you more concentration in something. And so that can be helpful if you find that you want to concentrate in that, right? I did get a master's degree. I got it in engineering management, though, because I knew that I wanted to go into leadership, right? I knew that that was the path that I wanted to go into. And so it really depends on kind of what you want to do with that in the future. I would say it's not 100% necessary to have grad school, but it always helps, right? So there's always that, you know, leveling, and I think of all things in kind of leveling, right? So if you do go spend that 2 years or however long in grad school, then you do come in at a higher level, and there are positions that may have been better suited for that, and things like that. So there's benefits and cons to both. So it's kind of a personal thing that depends on your situation, I think.
Thank you. Anna?
Yeah, really good question. I'm not applying to grad school for computer science, but I'm currently applying to continue studying biomedical engineering. And I think the advice that I've gotten of, do you want to go to grad school? Do you want to go straight into industry? It does really depend. Like the panelists have been talking about, it mostly depends on if you want to specialize in something. It's very possible to graduate with a bachelor's in computer science and go right to industry. I have lots of friends doing that who don't want to go to graduate school. But say you want, I don't know, additional education in a specific area. Maybe you want to do cybersecurity, or maybe you want to do data analysis or something like that as it relates to medical devices, and you want to get research experience or take more classes, then that's a perfectly, you know, that's a great reason to go to graduate school. So it all just depends on what you want to do. And if you decide to go into industry and later you decide you want to go to graduate school, it's never too late to go back. So you have a ton of different choices.
I agree. I like that answer. Okay. So we have a question for you, Adonna. Do you have any advice for navigating the corporate environment and things like negotiation?
Okay. So I'll start with negotiation. I think one of the things I learned from my very first job is that you should always negotiate. I think negotiation doesn't just mean like your salary. You can negotiate sign-on bonuses. You can negotiate extra PTO, kind of whatever is needed for your situation. But I would always recommend when you get that offer to negotiate. And my tips to that is doing research, right? So I think everybody says the same thing. It's going in, looking at the research of what do those numbers look like of other industry jobs at the same level, and saying, okay, this is kind of what I deserve. And the biggest thing to me about negotiating is not necessarily like getting more money, which is important because we also know that women are underpaid. One of the reasons is probably because we don't negotiate as much, right? So when you negotiate, you're building more salary on top of that every year, right? But one of the things that, you know, the reason is just to advocate for yourself. I think you have to go into the position already advocating for yourself. So if you negotiate with your future manager to get something, you show that you're an advocate. So when someone negotiates with me as a hiring manager, I am like, this is great. I know that they are going to fight for themselves, fight for these things they want. They're not afraid of hard conversations because hard conversations happen throughout the workplace, right? And so people are often afraid, like, if I try to ask for more, they're going to, you know, take away the offer or whatever it is. That doesn't happen, right? There's an open position. The company needs to fill that position. Typically, they want someone to fill it just as badly as you want a job, right? Because it's like, we have a gap right now. We need this resource. We need someone to come in and to help with this. And so if you've already got to the level of an offer, don't be afraid. I guess like the biggest piece of advice is don't be afraid above all of the other stuff of being prepared for the conversation, coming in with options. So that's kind of always what I do. I say, okay, I know I'm going to come in for this big hitter of like, increase my salary by X amount. A lot of times they may not want to do that, but I don't go with like, okay, you won't increase my salary. It's like, okay, well, you won't increase my salary, but how about giving me a sign-on bonus, right? Like I'm changing jobs. Maybe you would get a bonus at your previous job if that was a thing or anything like that. Or just now, you know that that exists, right? I didn't know that that existed when I first started working, that there was a thing that companies will just give you money for signing the offer. Right? Like, it's like, what? And so it's like asking for those things and knowing those things, right? And going down that list, it's like, maybe you first ask for salary, then you ask for sign-on bonus. And then you're like, well, just give me like a couple extra days of PTO, trying to get anything. Because it gives you a better rep, I feel like, there. So they know that that's how you are. And it gives you that practice. So that's kind of to negotiating. And then really quickly, I'll talk on navigating corporate America. I think that that's something that I'm still learning. So I've been in corporate America now about 10 years, which is kind of crazy to me. But I think it's something that I'm constantly navigating. I go to trainings. I've done crucial conversations. I go to panels to learn from other people's experiences, right? And take those pieces of advice everywhere I go. And try to spread that advice as well. I also think it's important to participate in like employee resource groups. So a lot of times corporations will have resource groups for, you know, people of color, or even we have some for Christians, LGBTQ, all of these resource groups that are here at Medtronic, and a lot of big companies have them. And so joining those to kind of get involved in that and seeing that, and that'll help kind of navigate, you know, corporate America as, you know, a woman of color, or as anybody who is, you know, trying to navigate corporate America.
Anna, can I bump that question to you? Because I know you just did an internship in corporate America. Maybe you had others, but how did you navigate being an intern in a corporation?
That's a great question. It's definitely, so working at Medtronic was my second internship. So I think I had a little bit more of an idea of how to function as an intern in the medical device industry. I might have had a little bit more difficulty the previous summer when I had, you know, first internship ever. So I moved to Oregon and I worked for Biotronic on a component of an implantable cardiac device. And that was really fun. I really enjoyed it. I think the biggest thing that I had to learn how to do was to work on a team. A lot of the, you know, times when I'm working on something in an academic setting, it's, you know, on my own, I'm doing a homework assignment, I'm studying for a test, maybe I'm collaborating with friends and we're bouncing ideas back and forth. But it's a little different actually working with people on a team, on a project, on something that's going to be implanted, you know, in a person. So that can be a little bit scary. And I think that one of the biggest things was analyzing how people react differently. Something that I had to do was we were working on this component and we were, you know, using a SMT line. So a pick and place machine was taking our component, placing it on the circuit board. And then, you know, there was solder. So it was all, you know, getting placed on the board and it was going through reflow. And during that process, I was working with both engineers and technicians. And there were definitely some frustrating moments where our final product comes off the line and it's perfect and it's beautiful. And then a light fell on it, which knocked all the components. And then, you know, people react to that differently. Some people need to step outside for a minute. Some people, you know, are just very quiet, just kind of processing what happened. So just learning how to give everyone their space, knowing how you react to that yourself. And then, you know, taking next steps, because what happens when a project that you poured a lot of time in has something fall on it and crush it? Because that's pretty disappointing. But it does happen. So then looking at the situation, okay, some of the components fell off, some of them are still on, and we're worried about, you know, getting the alignment perfect. So on the components where the light didn't hit it, are they aligned? I don't know. Can we wipe the solder off, take the components off, run it through the machine again, and then being able to take that time you need to think about it, let your team think about it, and then coming back calm and collected and working together to solve the problem. I think that's something that I don't experience as much in an academic setting, but definitely learned during my first internship.
Thank you so much for sharing. Okay, so I want to switch us over to a more technical question. I think it's technical, but and anyone can answer this question. Is there a template for designing an implantable medical device that you would recommend? Yvette doesn't know where to begin.
I'm not sure I quite understand if looking for a template for it. So I would start with, I guess, if you're looking for design, I'm not quite sure, but if you're looking at like what is required, like to release something like that through like the FDA, then maybe I can guide you. But I'm not sure on what that means. I don't know if Anna or Christi have any idea.
So speaking, I too don't have many ideas on how this question goes by, but there are many templates. You know, there is no certain template. Every medical device has a different, you know, structure, or if that's what you're asking for, everything is different. So I can't, you know, localize it to a certain point, but yeah, maybe Anna, you, if you have any needs.
Yeah, I see that you confirmed the yes requirements. And for medical devices, there are definitely like FDA requirements that you can see. That's something that I'm looking at right now because I'm starting to work on a senior capstone project. So with anything that I'm designing, I need to, you know, go through the steps and make sure that it's following all the rules and regulations from the FDA. So yeah, there's definitely requirements for designing medical devices. It just depends on what type of device.
Thank you. And I'm going to direct this one to all of you, and we can start with Christi. In your work in medical devices, how important is it to know about computer science or understanding coding?
I will definitely say that knowing coding is a great way to start with it. And it's completely fine if you're not known with it. I would suggest that, you know, when you interact with people, you learn, eventually learn. You need not freak out that, oh my God, I don't know I was in the same space at some point of my life. There's, you know, a starting point at some point of the life. You never know, gonna hesitate because I'm not knowing with coding. I should just back out of the medical devices. No. But yeah, definitely you need coding, some experience with coding, or you just need an interest. I will say, just have an interest and go for it, you know? So in my lab, we mostly use MATLAB. So MATLAB is mostly, you know, you need to know Python, C++, R programming. These are just basics, you know, little bit. And that's how, you know how a necklace is beaded. You know, you put beads in it, and that's how a beautiful necklace turns out. That's the same way. Just go for it. Know one language, then the other language. Go with the basics, and that's how you'll go to the coding. So definitely, you need coding, but then eventually you will go through it. Yeah.
Thank you, Christi. Who's next?
I can go. I would say that it is important. I would say now I'm a manager, so I don't necessarily code on the daily as much or really often ever. But every single engineer on my team is coding something, right? So whether they're using MATLAB, which is a huge system that we use, or Python or something, we are coding, and we're coding to create our devices, we're coding to do analysis on our devices. So it's like, you think we're electrical engineers, but it's like we still collect a lot of data, and the best way to analyze data is through computer science, right? So it's much easier, much faster. A lot of the data, I know people, like, sometimes you, like, people analyze data in Excel, right? But in order to really analyze data and really pull that together and automate that kind of stuff, you really need to do coding. And so I think it's important, but I want to echo what Christi said, is that's not to make it scary, right? It's really, you don't have to know everything about coding, right? Because you can learn one language and that helps you grow out to learn other ones. It's really that curiosity and that desire, right? Because you have to want to learn it, and it is something that can bring challenges and, you know, can be frustrating. You can write something and it completely destroys all of your code and you're like, what's going on? But it's something that is needed, and that I know that my team uses all the time. Even though we're not computer science, we're not the ones who are writing the code that goes on our devices, right? So there's a software team that writes the code that goes on the devices, but we're still using coding in our daily job.
Yeah, I can answer that. I would say that it's important to know. Obviously, I worked on a program when I was working at Medtronic, for the failure analysis for the continuous glucose monitors. But I will say, you know, even though I had that introductory computer science class, you know, in my major, and then thought, oh, that's the only computer science requirement I have, I'm not going to have to use this anymore. And then every single other class, you know, had some sort of coding component. So one, it gets easier over time. And two, when, you know, you go into an industry like the medical device industry and you're not a computer science major, you don't have to know everything about computer science. If you know a little bit, I'm personally really familiar with MATLAB. The program that I used at Medtronic was Python, and they're similar, and I had a little experience with Python, but knowing, having a background in MATLAB was super helpful. And then also using resources like YouTube, or just generally a Google search, what is a command that can help me do this, and then seeing what other people have done and advice is really helpful. So yes, it's important to know, but no, you don't have to know everything about it.
Thank you. Okay, and this is going to be our last question. So I want you to think back and imagine what you would tell your younger self, either your high school self, your middle school self, baby you, to prepare yourself for this major and this career path. We'll start with Adonna.
Okay. That's an interesting question. I think that I would definitely say, don't continually get discouraged. So I think especially in college and maybe a little bit of early career, there were a lot of moments where I felt like I'm just so discouraged, like I, especially in coding, right? Especially in coding, where it's like, there's no way I can ever do this, right? Like I forgot a semicolon and this whole thing is broken. Like, no way, this cannot be life, right? But I think that it's really like pushing through those things and learning it and realizing kind of like what Anna said is that I don't have to be an expert right now, right? I think there's some of it that's like, I can't do this. Like, I don't know everything about this, but it's like, you don't have to know everything about it and you can still do it. So I think that would be the advice that I would give.
I can go next. I think if I had to give one piece of advice to my younger self, like if it was my high school self, it would be, don't be afraid to try something new that you have zero experience in. Because, you know, this is the time you're supposed to be learning and experiencing different things and really figuring out, you know, what you want to do. So I clearly chose a very different path than the one I originally intended, but I'm having a great time with it. And even though, especially in the beginning, there was a lot of the self-doubt, I see people around me who have been doing robotics for years and they, you know how to code, they know how to do all of these things. It doesn't mean that, you know, you can't be an engineer just because you didn't start when you were really young. You can still learn all of these skills and try something completely new and, you know, graduate and you all become engineers at the end of the day. So that's the advice that I would give.
The one advice that I will give to my younger self is do not hesitate to talk to people. So I have experienced a lot of things. Many things I missed because I was afraid to ask something. Oh my God, how should I go and ask this? Is this, will this make me sound stupid? No, guys, that's nothing. I personally felt so stupid right now. Okay, I just should have walked to the person and asked. You know, that's how you, when you communicate, that's when you get knowledge and you share your knowledge. So don't afraid to ask questions or to communicate with people and learn with them. Don't be stagnant on your, you know, what I know is a good thing. I don't want to be open to other thoughts. So be open to new ideas, share those, take those ideas, brainstorm it, or just, yeah, just explore those ideas. Don't constrict yourself to one thing. Okay, this is something I need to do. I'll hold on to you. No, just get yourself freed with it and enjoy yourself. Yeah, please don't do too much study. Enjoy yourself as well.
I like that, Christi. Yes, don't study too much. Enjoy life. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and first of all, thank you so much to the panelists, Anna, Adonna, and Christi. Thank you so much for giving your time, participating and sharing your experiences with us. We are incredibly thankful to have you. It wouldn't be a webinar without a spiel. So I am going to start talking a little bit about the Aspirations in Computing community, which is one of NCWIT's signature programs and very phenomenal. So we like to say inclusion changes what's possible. And that is the spirit of the Aspirations in Computing computing program. So AIC came around in 2007 and they have worked to increase the participation and persistence of women in computing through continuous engagement, ongoing encouragement, and just building a community and a sense of belonging at every stage of the educational and professional development. I actually got involved with NCWIT through AIC and I have not left like as a volunteer and it just continues staying because it really is just a phenomenal program. So I'm going to share a little bit more. Some of the outcomes that AIC is able to claim, first, like the AIC community is a diverse network of 25,000 women, genderqueer, and non-binary technologists from ninth grade all the way through early IT workforce and computing workforce, technical workforce. And the AIC community, they make it, they graduate. You hear about attrition, you hear about women changing their majors and not feeling that sense of belonging and that sense of support. And AIC is really able to boast that, you know, 90% of their community members do persist in STEM. And part of that is having the opportunity to exchange ideas and advice, like Christi said, having somewhere to take your questions to. Questions are best when they can get answered. And I see a lot of questions going around in the AIC community, whether it's about projects or, you know, studying, whatever. And then also the AIC community has meetups. There's an award, which I'm going to talk about because it's open right now. There are outreach opportunities, there's networking, there's scholarships, there are internships, there's a career fair specifically for AIC community members. And more, there are opportunities to find mentors. There are just, it's crazy how vast this community is. And so I always encourage young people to join communities like this and to get involved with a network because of what they bring to you. And so I would really encourage you all to also do that. The last thing I want to mention about AIC is the fact that there is a collegiate award. There's also a high school award, but that has already closed for this season, I'm pretty sure. But for next year, if you are in high school, definitely look into that award. But the collegiate award just opened, and the AI Aspirations in Computing Award honors the technical contributions to a project that demonstrate like a high level of innovation and potential impact. So if you are currently an undergraduate student and you are or graduate student and you are working on a project or you have a past project that you'd really like to use to apply, please feel free to reach out. You can reach out to me and I will connect you to wherever you need to be connected to. I will answer your questions. There is more information and I will share it in the email that comes after this. And I'm just going to click through. I added a lot more slides than I really wanted to. Last but not least, thank you for coming. Help us improve this series. This is a series. The next webinar will be on November 13th. It will be computer science plus dance. So CS plus dance. And we'll have a dance crew that uses coding and technology and electronics to be a part of their performance. So registration for that will be shared in the email afterwards as well. And please take our evaluation. Thank you.